Have we entered the third heaven already? Man, it is so good to be here. I'll steal just two minutes right off the front of the sermon. Don't worry, I'll give it to you on the back. It is so good to be here. Thank you so much for your wonderful gifts of prayer, of finances, of just everything that you've done for myself and my family. It's such an honor and a privilege to be invited to be a part of your church community. It was fun the other day. I'm packing up the other end of our life, and it's very humbling. There's a great sermon probably for another day, how your stuff is worth $400 at a yard sale, and you only sold half of it. You give the rest away. But we still had a truckload, and so there was a team there, and it was hot, and those crates were heavy, and just thank you to that team. Thank you to Mark. There were some keys that were locked in a car, and after a while, Mark started sharing some new words that I'd never heard before, not since the Marines. I'll have to check with him later and find out what those might have meant. Thank you so much, each and every person. What to speak about? I'm kind of a sermon series guy, unless the Lord jumps in and redirects me in a different direction. So I've been thinking about this a long time. And I thought what I should speak about would be CCT. Coshocton Christian Tabernacle. It is a connected church. It is a committed church. It is a transforming church. That is your mission statement. Let's talk about being connected. Connected. The communities that I've lived in, there's always a little bit of a disconnect amongst the people. I'm sure it's not like that in Coshocton. But let me just share with you what it's like in some of the Catskill Mountain regions where we've been living the last 15, 20 years or so. There are the people that were born in the country. They can chase their relatives all the way back to the early 18th century, some of those folks. You go to the cemeteries and you see that the tombstones, they go back to, you see people, 1700, and their descendants live in that community. And then there are the foreigners, the people that moved in. For us, we live in the echo of New York City a lot of years, so the region that we grew up, that my children have grown up in and I've been for these last 15 years, it's very similar to this. The mountains are probably a little higher and maybe a little tighter. Lots of water, beautiful places. We actually moved to the city coming to Coshocton. The community that we just came in from was about 3,000 people, and the place where I work was 1,500, so we're city living now. This is cool. But those people that came in, the foreigners, the people from the city, there were different uncomplimentary terms for them. One of them was called the Sidians, right? And so there's this animosity, this disconnect between the people. September 10th, 2001, I was sitting on a stone wall out behind the parsonage, and I was looking at the red sky, and I'm not a superstitious fellow, but for some reason my spirit was super heavy. And it should have been a joyous time, because I had a baby girl just about getting ready to be born. And my mother-in-law was coming in tomorrow. But I remember just sitting out on that stone wall, and just kind of praying about the region, and I just felt super heavy. I couldn't even explain it. The next morning, September 11th, I met an accountability partner for prayer. And he too, he says, I feel terrible. And I don't even know how to explain it. I said, I know just what you mean. I don't know. So we just kind of prayed about a few things and ate some scrambled eggs and went about our business. And all of a sudden over the radio came this news. A plane had hit the Twin Towers. Unbelievable. Jeez, I hope everybody was okay. What a horrible accident. And then I think my mother-in-law's in New York City. Oh my goodness. And then I heard the second plane had struck the towers. And I could only imagine the carnage that was going down in that city. It must have been awful. And I wondered about my mother-in-law.
was she okay down there? You know, was somebody going to, were people going to be taking out the trains, the airports? What was going to happen next? And it was very interesting. I called for a prayer meeting that night. I'd only been a pastor there a week. And you know what? Into that church came somebody who had never been into that church before. And this is a little rural community. And there was a group of people. Some of them had been from the city, and some of them had lived there all their lives. That was it. They were connected, and we cried out to the living God for His grace, for His mercy, for His comfort, for His protection. There was unity in the connection, and it didn't matter if your hometown was Manhattan or Big Hollow, Maple Crest, New York. You were united, one with Christ. And there was actually, again, there was a person there who had never been to church. No. We need to connect. It's part of our mission statement. It's what the Lord would have us do. It's what we're going to take a look at this morning. We're going to study a couple of scriptures, and I'm going to teach you a brand new word. All right. We should not make it difficult to the Gentiles who are turning to God, the Apostle Paul. Our job is to connect. Now, let's talk about the original disconnect. Quick review of Genesis. Adam himself was connected with God in a special way that you and I can only imagine at this point. He was physically, tangibly, emotionally, mentally, spiritually connected with God. Right there, like this. And it still wasn't enough. And so Eve was created. And Adam and Eve were connected just like this, with one another and with God Himself for fellowship. What happened with the disconnect? What was Adam thinking? How could he drop the responsibility like he did? What was that about? Did he just forget for a minute what God told him not to do? I mean, was his love for his wife so great that he would rather be on earth with her than in heaven with God? I mean, what happened there? But the truth of the matter is, that was the disconnect. And we're done with this relationship with the Lord. There's now a wall between us. It's a sin wall. It's a sin wall. You know what happened that day? It was a declaration of war. And it was a declaration of war in the heart of Adam, in the heart of every man and woman since, that I, Lord, am against you. I am the one that want to be in charge. I know what's best for me and for those around me. Well, we can see how that's worked out. Very poorly. And as a result of that, each and every person now fights that war. Now, I am assuming, hopefully rightly so, that many of you have fought that war and you have decided that, you know what, I just give up. We've tried to make religion to be the place where we come back to get it right with God. We've been trying to get it right with God ever since. And you go study any religion, and that's what it's about, right? Trying to climb the mountain, being good enough to get to God. You know the cool thing about Christianity? God came off the mountain for you and me. That is the cool thing about being a Christian. How do we help connect those that are disconnected? There's a Greek term called oikos. Isn't that fun? You can pretend like you're from Australia, right? Try it. Oikos. Oikos. Oi. Oi. You know? Oikos. What is an oikos, for crying out loud? Sounds like something Popeye would say if he slipped down the deck or something, right? Oikos. Oikos originates from the Greek. It's a noun. It means extended family. Extended family. Now, what is an extended family? Well, I don't know. For crying out loud, in my house, we got 10 kids. You know?
Well, an interesting thing happened a couple of years back. All of a sudden, there was this gal that was hanging around a lot. And then I got this other beautiful daughter. Oh my goodness, she's awesome. You know, what a woman for my son. And then this other little girl showed up, you know, and she's about this long, and oh boy, she stole my heart. You know what? I don't have any kids anymore. You know? I got 10. It's cool. The first unit instituted by God was the family. The family. Mommies and daddies, guess what? You will never have an opportunity for evangelism with any other person in the whole world than those people that sit right there at the dinner table with you. Right? I love what Ronald Reagan said. He says, all great change begins at the dinner table. That is true. That is your oikos, your family. Your family that you do in life with. Now there's some other people in your oikos. Other people in your oikos. Who might those people be? Your oikos extends to your workplace. There's probably a person or two that you work very closely with. If you have your own business, there's probably regular customers that you see on a regular basis. You see them all the time. That is your oikos. That is your circle of influence. Now, this is a wonderful, wonderful word and a wonderful, wonderful concept to try to get your heads around. Listen to how cool this is. First of all, it is extremely, extremely simple. Right? We try to write these books and come up with these plans. Oikos, as simple as all get out. Here's what's really cool about it. It fits all ages and levels of maturity. You know what that means? That means, mom and dads, if you've poured your heart, soul, and love into that kid and they start understanding Christian principles, it means that your 10-year-old, they're starting to form their own oikos, aren't they? They've got friends that they're touching at school. They are recognized by their teachers as being the kid that you want in your class. You got a teenager that you've been pouring your love into, maybe somebody that's like 15 years old or so in a day or two, then that person begins to have their oikos, their circle of influence. You think there isn't bad things going on in the school? Woo! You need to rub your eyes and blink. There is a ton of tough stuff going on in schools. There's a ton of tough stuff going on in that school, right? That's a Christian school. You influence your child. It's simple, and it works for all ages. You're 72, your oikos is your friends in the coffee shop. Don't think that they're all saved. They're probably not. It flows naturally from a Christian lifestyle. A wonderful pastor once said, I'd much rather see a good sermon than hear a good sermon. Did you catch that? People are watching you. They're looking at you. They want to know what a Christian is like. Do you walk the talk? Can you exude love when maybe you haven't been shown it? That's tough stuff, all right? It flows naturally out of your Christian lifestyle. You've probably had people ask you. I've had people ask me, why are you cheerful all the time? Why are you happy all the time? Oh man, talk about an open door. I am not happy all the time. The root word of happy is happenings. All right? You will never control what happens to you. You can. I know I've tried. You probably have too. But you can control your attitude. That song, that praise, the praise team song, those four sets and the special, what are they talking about? They're talking about the joy that comes from living a peaceful life in the presence of the Lord. That's where it's at. That's where it's about. It facilitates growth of a Christian church like nothing else. It finances itself. You teach somebody about the Lord and they get it, they're off to the next person to share the message and the love that you show to them. And it's faithful to the Bible. It's just that simple. Evangelism and church growth depends on it. Let's play Jeopardy for a second, all right? It's the $600 question. Under evangelism
and church growth. All right? Here's the answer. Yes, it can. For $600, what is the question? Nice try, but wrong answer. The question is, can evangelism really be that simple? And the answer is yes, it can. Let's take a turn and study a couple of examples from the greatest teacher that ever was, Jesus Christ himself, and let's get a handle on three interesting concepts. There could be more, but they're cooking that dinner as we speak. So let's look at three examples. Let's jump to Mark chapter 5, verse 19, the wrap it up verse. True and simple, connecting Jesus' lifestyles. First of all, personal stories give hope. Now let me give you the backdrop on the scripture. Jesus has gone across the lake to the Gerasenes, and there's this demon-possessed man. Now, people are trying to tie him up and constrain him. You can't put a chain on this guy that'll hold him. He busts free, and he's a cutter. Alright? He takes stones and he cuts himself all over, and he just screams because he's filled with these demons, these evil spirits. And Jesus comes, and you know the story. The demons, they are cowering. They know who Jesus is. Now it's funny, a lot of people don't know who Jesus is. Demons know who Jesus is. And this demon-filled guy, the demons come, "What do you want with us, Jesus? And have you come to cast us into the lake?" They know what's coming. They know a judgment is coming. And so they're scared. And they're just throwing this guy in convulsions. "What are you doing?" You know. He says, "Get out, you unclean spirit." Well, demons are kind of interesting sort of folks. They like a territory. Once they stake it, they don't like leaving. Alright? And so they say, "Cast us out into the pigs." Alright? Now, pigs in those times and places are associated with demonic sacrifice, right? So that'd be a cool thing if you're a demon. I mean, if you got to get kicked out of a being, why not be a pig, all right? Then you can be sacrificed to your satanic god. Jesus casts them out. 2,000 pigs. Can you imagine that? I spoke with a hog farmer here this morning. 2,000 pigs. Now, that's a lot of money. Those pigs went charging down the hill and were drowned in the lake. Now that's the power that the living God has over a demon. They were killed on the spot. Those demons didn't have a chance. And this man was so thankful and so happy. And there's an interesting verse a couple of lines before. It says he wanted to go with Jesus. He was ready to be a disciple. That was it. His life was changed. He was ready to follow him personally. And when the people saw what had happened, and they saw this guy clothed in his right mind, you know what? It says in the Bible that they were afraid. Why be afraid of somebody that's coming out of a hell lifestyle? Why would you be afraid of them? This guy had found the Lord. He had found hope. He had been saved, and he knew it, and he just wanted more than anything to follow Jesus. Personal. What did Jesus say to him? Well, Jesus said, "No. You know, you go home and you tell your own people how much the Lord has done for you and how much he's had mercy on you. You go tell your story that I shared with you, and you give people hope." Watch what happens 2 chapters later. Chapter 7 of Mark. Now Jesus is traveling around. He says he left the vicinity of Tyre and he went through Sidon and down to the Sea of Galilee into the region of Decapolis. Now he was just there 2 chapters ago. He's come back. Look what's happened. There were some people who brought a man who has been deaf and could hardly talk, and they begged Jesus to place his hand on him. Now how did they know about Jesus? How do they know that Jesus could change a life and save a life? How do they know this? They knew it because that demon-possessed man was sent back to Decapolis where he lived to tell his story. Let me tell you, you know who I was. Look at the scars. You see, I was bound. I cut myself. You know who I was. You know where I lived. You ran from me. Now look at me. I believe in the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. He healed me. He can heal you. And there were people that believed that story. And they told that story. And when Jesus came circling them back and around, man, they were lined up and they were waiting. And I kind of wonder, what did that deaf mute guy do after he got his tongue loosened? You see, if you've had your spirit loosened by the power of the living God, it is not a secret to keep. It is a story to be shared. It gives other people hope. Let's jump on another story. Let's jump on Zacchaeus out of Luke chapter 19. Again, the wrap-up verse is verse 9. Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, Zacchaeus, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." Remember Zacchaeus? Zacchaeus was a tax collector. He collected taxes for a living. Now, the way that it worked in those days, you got this appointment from the Roman officials to collect the taxes. All right? So if your taxes were $500, and I'm a tax collector, when I come to visit you, I make my money off of collecting taxes. So I got to give the Romans the $500, but I make my living by what I collect above that. So your taxes, Tim, are $1,000. Right? So what it costs you, right? Don't forget who I am. I'm a Roman tax collector. I have appointed authority to collect. You owe me $1,000. You don't do it, I got your trucks, right? Take your hammer too, right? We'll auction it. Get me $1,000. So these are the kind of people that are tax collectors. They are hated, they are lowlifes, they have no scruples or regards. Everybody's looking at Zacchaeus, and they know who he is because he comes and visits each and every person in the village. He knows who they are, and he has extorted these people money. And he wants to see Jesus. And personal stories, they rock the conventional boat. They rock the boat because Jesus came, and here's probably one of the worst guys in the whole region. He is just a jerk personified times 10, and he got saved. Him, Lord? Come on, not him. Yes, him. Zacchaeus got saved. He met the living God. There were people that were mad about that. They didn't like it. They said, "You saved a bum like him?" You know what Zacchaeus said? He said, "I've been wrong. Jesus, please, please don't take back what you've given to me today." He says, I repent. I haven't had time to think about this all the way through, but now that I think about it, you're right, I have been a jerk. So this is what I'm going to do. I am going to give back half of everything I own right now, today. Love offering, giving back to the poor. Right? What's your household worth right now? Well, if you got a house and some retirement, and I don't know, grandma's antique brooch, what are you worth? $200,000 maybe? Yeah, maybe. He gave away $100,000 then and there, like that, to help the poor. And he said, "Furthermore, anybody that I put the blocks to, anybody that I extorted, I will pay it back of my remaining money four times, fourfold. So I stole $500 from you, $2,000 back." All right? I'd have to say that that's changed life. Jesus change that life, and personal stories are going to rock the conventional boat. All right, you're going to see people saved that make you mad. All right, makes you mad they got saved. All right, Jeffrey Dahmer. You know, nobody wanted anything to do with that guy. Remember him? All right, he was a serial killer. He's going to the electric chair. Nobody wanted anything to do with that guy, but his lawyers were chatting with them. And you know, their job is to defend. You gotta defend people even when they're guilty. You know, that's the way the American system works. You're not guilty until it's said so by a group of jury members. Funny thing about the lawyers, guess what? They're Christians. The only people in the world that would talk to this man on death row were his Christian lawyers. Guess what happened? He got saved. This guy that brutally killed co-eds and women, who knows how many? He didn't even know how many people he killed. Guess what? He'll be in heaven. How do you like that? We better like it, because that's the power of the living God. He didn't come not only for the best of the sinners, he came for the worst of the sinners. Furthermore, there is no such thing as a rated sinner. You either know about the Lord and you're forgiven and you get mercy, or you don't. It doesn't matter how good you are. This Lord of ours came for us all, and his story, his changed life, people's changed lives will rock the boat. And it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you think about it. There was people there grumbling that this guy got saved. Church is going to look different when saved. People that are new Christians, they're messy. Oh, they're a mess. You know? I'm working with this gal. I love her to pieces, but you know, she's working with some baggage. She's coming out of it. We had a chat just before I left. I said, you know, you're going to have to change. Here's some things you got to look at. Take a look at it. The Lord is patient. He is kind. He is long-suffering. But you're a different world. You're a different girl than you used to be now. Don't stop walking. Don't stop walking the talk. Keep ditching the stuff out of your life. Be that example. Her story rocks the boat. You know, I'm sure there are people that look at her and say, she's a child of the Lord. She's on the journey. Last story. Peter, Acts chapter 11, verses 15 through 18. Peter has had this vision. Now, there's two stories kind of going on, just to set you up from Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10, there's a fellow named Cornelius. Cornelius is not a Jew. He is a Roman centurion. Right? So that's kind of weird. Right? So this guy from Rome loves the Lord? Yeah, he does. He's not from a conventional Jewish background. He's not a member of the way. He just loves God. He doesn't know much about it, but he's on the journey. And he's devout. He's faithful. And he's praying for someone to come and help him. Now, in the meantime, you got Peter. And Peter's kind of, he's doing some evangelism, doing some speaking, but he's kind of keeping it in the circle of the Jewish realm. Right? It's kind of like me preaching to you folks here this morning. Right? What would happen if I went down to the bar some Friday night and spoke down there? Would that be cool? You know? Well, Peter didn't think that'd be cool. Right? This is for Jewish people. If you change and you come and you be like a Jew, then you're good enough to come into the church. But the Lord had another lesson for Peter to learn. And he dropped that sheet down three times with all these different types of animals on it. He says, Peter, go kill and eat. Peter goes, what? Lord, I'm a good Jew. I'm not going to eat that. I'm not going to eat those nasty pigs. Remember what you did? You know, there's 2,000 dead pigs. I'm not eating that stuff. And he kept at it. And he gave him that vision three times. And Peter started thinking about it. He started getting it. He said, you know what? We're calling these people unclean. And the Lord says, my death was for them, too. You go minister to them. And Cornelius, he set his servants to go get Peter. And while Peter was thinking about all this, there was a knock on the door, and the Lord said, hey, those guys down there, you go with them. You go with them. You see, personal stories are for everybody. Everybody. And Peter started to get it. And he says, I remember what the Lord had said. John baptized you with water, but you'll be baptized with the Spirit. So if God gave them the same gift as he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think I could stand in God's way? When the people who were arguing against Peter say, hey, don't go out in the community. This is our closed community. This is our closed church. People got to come here and be good enough for us. When they heard this, they had no further objections. And they praised God, and they said, so, even to the Gentiles, God has granted repentance that leads to life. Personal stories are for us all. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Back to your Oikos. There's a little blurb handout in your bulletin. Here's some surprises about people that don't go to church. So that's your homework. Read those things. Let me just share with you some interesting statistics from Winard's book, The Master Plan. This book is an old book. This was a longitudinal research study. It was done across 3 years with several thousand people. All right, so this isn't just, you know, walk over to Walmart for a half an hour and then say, okay, this is what it says. This is a long study. This is what it found about how people find Christ. Some people come to church because of a special need. You know, there's a crisis in their family. It's a divorce or an accident or an illness. That's 1-2%. People that will walk in this door, that's 2-3%. People that have ministry of the pastor, well, there's good news. I'm going to grow your church. If we get 100 people next year, I'll be directly responsible for 5 or 6 of them. That's all I'm going to get, guys. 5-6%. Visitation programs, 1-2%. Sunday school, 4-5%. Evangelistic crusades. I heard Pastor Nick mention one coming up. Sounds fun. Cool. You know how many people will get saved there? 0.5%. Other church programs, 2-3%. Relative or friend brought somebody to church and connected with Jesus Christ. Anywhere from 75-90%. I'm going to do an experiment. I didn't ask this of anybody. But out of wild curiosity, if you are here because you had a drug problem, as in you got drugged to church when you were little by your mom and dad. If you are here because your mom and dad poured the love of Christ into your heart, body, mind, and soul, or you're here because a good friend brought you to church, I want you to stand up. Stand up. Do you see how this works, people? Do you see how it works? I got nothing against Billy Graham Crusades. They are awesome. But guess what? Go ahead and see. Billy Graham Crusades worked because somebody in the local church looked another person in the eye and said, you come. Come be a part of this. You want to fill the sanctuary up? I think I read someplace there's 1,000 seats. Only see one person up there. Yeah, two people. All right. This place, we've got to fill this place up. This was built for the glory of the Lord. It's exciting. It's exciting. We have got to connect with unsaved people. We've got to connect with those who don't know the love, the joy, the peace that comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. We've got to connect. How do we do that? You just proved it to me. You just proved it to me. The only way that we're going to do that is we're going to take our Oikos group just like this. We're going to take the 8 to 15 people that we have influence over in our lives, and we're going to ask them to church. And we're getting close to eating, so I'm going to, that's your homework. You got to read the 10 reasons, you know, about church, unchurched people, all right? So we do that. But we got to ask our family and our friends to come to church. We have got to do it. Because as you just proved to us, that's the only way that people come to church. The only Jesus that most people are ever going to know is from their Oikos group, from their family, from their close friends, from their close co-workers that they respect. That will grow the church. We don't go to church. We are the church. Lord, thank you so much for every person who came here this morning. Thank you for the ways that we love you, Lord, and the ways that families have just shared the message, shared the story, shared the hope across the generations. But there's more people in our circles that need the story, Lord. More people. We've got family members that aren't saved. We've got close friends, co-workers, people that we have relationships with. We already have the relationships. All we got to do is share the stories. When we do that, we give hope. We give saving knowledge, power, and grace, as we spoke about in our worship songs, as we saw in the video, Lord. We give you to the people. And that's what you ask us to do, Lord. You ask us to know you and to share you with everybody that we know. So I just ask that you bless this church family. Bless our church, Lord, as we go forth to love and serve you. It's true what it says over the doors. It really is the mission field that we walk into. And Lord, I lay down the gauntlet, I lay down the challenge. Let an opportunity unfold this week for every person here to invite a person from their Oikos group to church. Let it be so. Let your message be shared and your love flow across this community and beyond. In the name of Jesus, we pray.